Good evening. Warmly welcome you all for the third session of Strategic Way Forward amidst the COVID-19 pandemic webinar series. We are group number 3 and our industry is healthcare and pharmaceutical. Healthcare and pharmaceutical industry includes healthcare providers such as hospitals and clinics, pharmaceutical manufacturers, medical equipment and insurance providers. Looking at the healthcare sector profile of Sri Lanka, in general, the life expectancy of a typical person is 75 years, and current per capita spending on healthcare is around 30,000 per year. In our discussion, we mainly focus on healthcare providers and pharmaceutical manufacturers. In terms of pharma, pharmaceutical market in Sri Lanka is estimated to be worth $400 million. Regarding healthcare, Sri Lanka's expenditure on healthcare, both public and private, is 3.9% of GDP, with around 56% from government health expenditure. There are 555 government hospitals and 200 private hospitals. Against the backdrop of COVID, Sri Lanka currently has adequate medical supplies and a deficit in drugs is not imminent. However, a larger concern was the patients' accessibility to drugs due to an island-wide curfew being imposed. On the other hand, the private hospitals were at a loss due to lower patient count. To dive deeper into the healthcare and pharmaceutical industry in Sri Lanka and to understand how well it has managed the crisis, in today's session we have with us a very special guest, a businesswoman and a role model in our country. She is the first female group CEO of a public quoted conglomerate in Sri Lanka. In 2016, she took over as the managing director of Hemas Pharmaceuticals, Surgicals and Diagnostics, where she was responsible for driving company's local and regional expansion. She is a fellow of the Chartered Institute of Management Accountants and an alumna of the Executive Leadership Program at Harvard Business School. She has also represented Sri Lanka as a member of national netball and basketball teams. Moreover, she serves as the president of Sri Lanka Chamber of Pharmaceutical Industry. In 2019, she was recognized as being one of the 12 top women change makers in the country by the Parliament of Sri Lanka. She is none other than the Group CEO of Hemas Holdings PLC, Ms. Kasturi Chellaraja Wilson.
How are you doing these days?
Thanks, and I wish all of you all and your families a blessed new year. I'm good. I started the new year, I think just before new year, we've been starting with a bit of work. I'm trying to drive the group through a transformation. I've learned in life only during uncertain times you have opportunities, so you need to work harder. So yeah, I'm enjoying it so far.
So without further ado, let's begin with our discussion. Hemas Holdings PLC is a diversified corporate with focused interest in not just on healthcare, but also on consumer, mobility and leisure. And Hemas Healthcare is one of the largest private sector healthcare providers with a dominant presence across the entire healthcare value chain. Could you brief us, what are the businesses under the umbrella of healthcare and how had been their performance in pre-COVID context?
You're right, Hemas is actually, we call ourselves a consumer brand, healthcare and mobility business conglomerate. We just divested the hotels. That was, we had this agenda about a year and a half ago. So on the healthcare aspect, we kind of have been leaders in Sri Lanka. We kind of play in the, with the largest play in the integrated healthcare system, which is from health services in hospitals. We may not be the largest hospital chain, but we are. We have hospitals. We've got we're the largest importer of pharmaceuticals. I don't pride ourselves with saying largest. I say we're the best importer and distributor. So all the big global brands, who's who of the business in terms of MNCs, the big brands which are global manufacturers are with us. they simply stay with Hemas purely because we are transparent. We focus a lot on ethics and compliance, so that's there. And we also have the largest tablet manufacturing plant in the pharmaceutical manufacturing. So in the pharmaceutical space, we are very big, and then we've coupled it with hospitals. So in a healthcare point of view, from a patient, we kind of give them the services as well as give them medicines. I would love to tell have them not have medicines, but give them medicines when they need to take medicines. So that's our portfolio, consists of the hospital chain, the manufacturing part of pharma, and the import and distribution of pharma. So actually, on pre-COVID, we as a country, we were reliant on imports for pharmaceuticals. That's because we are a small country. We were living in, when you're importing, your pricing is a lot of exposure to exchange. And because the Sri Lankan economy was not in the best in health, we had our rupee devaluing. And just to give you a framework and for you all to understand, pharmaceutical industry globally is regulated, and Sri Lanka is regulated. In 2016, the government decided to take the commonly used drugs, which constitute about 50% of the consumption or 60% of the consumption, was brought under price control. So globally, from an economist point of view, when you bring price control, you need to have a pricing mechanism. So we believe that competition brings in price, but the government believe no. So they brought the price control, but they didn't bring a price mechanism. So the pre-COVID, we really, really struggled with the rupee under stress, and without a pricing mechanism, and with the regulators also not engaging in an effective manner at that point, we were struggling in terms of how do you sustainably operate. On a hospital's point of view, we realized, and in the pharma point of view, we realized from Sri Lankan our citizens, we have 70% of our citizens have in some form of NCDs, that is cardiovascular, diabetes, hypertension, cancer, anything lifestyle related. And by that, you saw hospital services also pivoting around that, and pharmaceutical products pivoting around that.
So ma'am, my first question is, where did Sri Lanka stand in healthcare and pharmaceutical industry, specifically in terms of consumer innovation, investments, and competition from domestic and multinational firms?
Do you know, pharmaceutical industry is the most investment heavy R&D industries. So Sri Lanka hadn't, we are not a R&D country, whether it's pharma, whether it's anything, we don't, whether it's technology. We have done now a bit of R&D and development when it's apparel. Apparel, we are globally excellent because we've had our industry stalwarts learning from the best and being relevant and investing on innovation. So the global pharma, where we stood on innovation, so one thing Sri Lanka did well is had an excellent healthcare system. Our national healthcare program and system is absolutely excellent. They, by default, we actually would make sure that we had the best in class drugs accessible to our patients. So you would find, even if you don't find in many other countries, in developing countries, you would find the best in terms of AstraZeneca, Pfizer, Abbott's of the world, the top pharma companies present here. That way, we had access to innovative drugs. We didn't manufacture it, nor did we have the capacity to manufacture it. Of course, with COVID, what really happened is we understood every global supply chain got disrupted. So we, like any other country, so the world's pharmaceutical products need raw materials. One raw, and the raw material co-ingredient is called API. World's API is about 60% is from China. So when that got disrupted, we all got awakening, not only Sri Lanka, everybody got awakening that you're kind of excessively vulnerable when you are an import dependent country. Remember, we can easily say that, but we are only 20 million. Out of the 20 million, 10 million approximately go into the free healthcare system of the state. So private market, you and I, pharmaceutical, we buy from the pharmacies, that's another 10. So you're talking about a small economy, right? To make the numbers work. So but the country really did want to be self-sufficient in some basic drugs. We started promoting domestic manufacturing. So we as a country have an agenda wanting domestic manufacturing, but that is for the standard drugs, which are like more NCDs than generic ones. Are we a science-driven, innovation-driven country? No, we are not. But having said that, we can find the space we want to play. Maybe in 10, 15 years, we can say we are innovative in certain things. So if you look at Singapore, it has 6 million people. But they do pick a niche of pharmaceuticals, some injectables, and they do innovate and they invest in R&D. That's billions of dollars. And they do that. Do we have that capacity? No, we don't. But we can attract people, but we need to offer them certain incentives to come in. Our access to innovation, which is important for you and I, because diseases are changing, has to be through imports, has to be through partnerships. And what are we talking about? Domestic manufacturing. Remember, domestic manufacturing, even if you go down that road, our raw material has to be imported. So it's like India. India also 50% of the raw materials are imported, and they have a billion people almost. So what we have done is our healthcare system is excellent. That's why when a poorest person has access to healthcare, and the quality of healthcare treatment you get is absolutely excellent. Our midwife system is excellent. But will we be an innovative country? No, we won't be. Not for the near future. Even if we invest, we will invest in infrastructure to do production systems. Over time, we can learn to be innovative, but it's a lot of investment, it's a lot of time and knowledge we need to learn, skills we need to develop. So long years ago, when Germany was an innovative country, they were doing manufacturing and innovation. And that's how they decided to do the run-of-the-mill, just excellence in production to China. China got trained on that. And Germany stuck to their innovation. They outsourced the production there. So it's something like that. It's not going to happen overnight. It won't even happen in the next 5 years. But we start building on it. If it's agenda, then we have to see the right partnerships, right markets. And our 20 million population is not going to be enough to get a return on an investment of on an asset. We have put the biggest plant here. But that's done with the agenda to find the partner to export. It has to make economic sense. So your capital employed has to make sense. So I don't think we are all, only thing I can say we are really excellent is we have excellent healthcare systems. Our policy at the moment still permits the new innovative drugs to come in, and that should continue. What we don't need is there are these generic drugs which are imported from India, the most like the, you know, one drug, it's like, one t-shirt will have different varieties. One drug will have 10 different brands. All are supposed to work the same way. You can have a brand at 10 rupees and 5 cents. So all we need to move is don't have 10 brands. Take 5 brands from Sri Lanka. Keep the new brand, the big brands also to come in. So policy-wise, there's a lot to be done. It's not only an economic thing. That's the problem with healthcare. When you make a policy, it's not only economics. It's healthcare outcomes. The wrong economic policy can ultimately impact a healthcare outcome of a city, of a patient, which shouldn't be the case.
So we all know that the COVID-19 pandemic outbreak has caused a huge economic shock, and it has disrupted the businesses of all scales and the industries across the world, causing prolonged uncertainty. So, ma'am, how would you characterize the impact of COVID-19 on healthcare and pharmaceutical industry?
So COVID-19 has had a huge impact of every industry, Sri Lanka, globally, everywhere. The initial impact on pharmaceutical industry was the panic of the pandemic being in China and people, the whole world, not having access to the raw material. So there was this whole thing of shortages of drugs, because if you don't have the raw material, we don't have drugs. But Sri Lanka was more resilient because we are a small country. You can negotiate for a quantity because it's not going to break anybody's supply chain. But the cost of operating in COVID environment really skyrocketed. It skyrocketed A from exchange point of view, B from supply chain and logistics point of view. So that was a huge impact on for pharma side. In the country perspective, even if you had to be safe and you have all the protocols, pharmaceuticals couldn't stop working. You had to work, because if you know, everybody in the first lockdown was shouting, whatever you do, keep pharmacies open. That's because 70% of our people need some diabetic drug or whatever, and these are life-threatening stuff. So that is, from a business point of view, that was one of the businesses which still got lesser impacted versus the others. On a portfolio of a pharmaceutical, you would see things like antibiotics not having sales, because people didn't get infected, because people were wearing masks and you weren't prone to be more safe in terms of viruses and things like that. So that industry, big initial challenge was the supply chain. Second challenge is, how do you get items to the pharmacy and manage logistics in this environment when everybody is supposed to be on lockdown? How do you get all the regulator to the government, to the police, to the army, all to understand how it works? So initially it was a lot of stress for us to get it done. But I guess when you see, that's the only point I saw the government, private sector working and working efficiently to make sure they had a process, a one contact point to get everybody's trucks approved. You find competition co-loading and using one truck and sharing stuff, because we know it was all done in the sense that a patient needed to be looked after. But going fast tracking on the longer term, I guess the challenge would be that in COVID times, how will the portfolio and the diseases shift? How do you go and sell and market normally doctors prescribed? How are these patients going to go and access? The business model of operating might change, because we are more on a digital side of it. Like any other business, we have to change faster because the demand is there. But the demand comes through different channels versus a traditional channel. So those challenges are there. Pharmaceutical local manufacturing had become a focus from a government point of view, just to reduce the impact of and give domestic economy a kickstart, which is a very good thing and we support it. However, the challenges we'll face in that is, we are a small economy, we are not a science-driven country. We need relevant partnerships to make sure that they teach the competency and technology to us so that we can start manufacturing. And we need also to find an angle of export, because this cannot be only these kind of plants. Now, our plants cost us about 3.5 billion rupees. 3.5 billion rupees, you put it into Sri Lanka, you're not going to get return for the next 15, 20 years. So you need to. So it's easy to say, it's not. That's why I keep saying, when it's pharmaceutical, you're taking it inside, swallowing it, and you are expecting an outcome of a healing. It's like a spaceship, some of these factories, when you walk in. Your suit, it's compressed chambers, there's zero contamination to come at that quality. And the quality matters. Quality of process matters. So technically, that's a challenge, but I think Hema's put the money in because we thought we should be the leaders with all our excellent partners with the global manufacturers. How do we bring them to Sri Lanka? And my ambition and our board is to make sure we can start generating revenue by exporting and making Sri Lanka a place for domestic market as well. It's going to be a challenge. It's not easy. I'll tell you, we don't have all the answers, but we are trying to figure it out. On the hospital side of it, as I said before, that is some, I think I'm most proud of was the hospitals, simply because those healthcare workers didn't have a choice. They had to come to work. They had to come to work every day. With the second lockdown, I saw that we had one hospital in Lavathala, and that was a hot spot. Every time when you have people walking into the ETU, you know that invariably if you have 10 patients, two are saying Badakakuma, but it's COVID. So you have to have our doctors and nurses who are trained very well, and they have to be protected. You have to have your safety protocols. And the challenge there from a business point of view is that while you are investing so much in safety and safety protocols, your revenue is not going to be there, because you and I don't go to hospitals because we don't want to get any infection. So revenue wise, it was much less. We were operating at 50% of the revenue, but cost wise, it was much more. So it's a huge challenge for hospitals. All hospitals face challenges because you don't have the same revenues, but or the patient footfall, but you also have increased costs. So yeah. So those are the challenges we felt during COVID. But I mean, in the medium term and short term, these are one of the businesses which will have more tailwind in terms of opportunities and growth. So consumers, healthcare, these are the kind of industries which are more resilient during these times.
Hello, madam. I'm Kushani, and I wish you a very happy new year. And my question is, how this pandemic situation affected your company, and what are the strategies taken by the entire healthcare sector?
So the hospitals, for the first lockdown, we felt that we got impacted for about a month. We quickly bounced back, and we saw rapidly, because of, I think they felt it was safe with all the safety. We were one of the first COVID safety hospitals, so we had quite a decent footfall. It bounced back, but the pharmaceutical manufacturing and imports, both we saw good numbers and growth, growing faster than the market, simply because of a few things. When we controlled quite a significant amount of the market share, it was important that we were the first off the block. So when there was lockdown, even we got permission, and from the, I think there was no day we didn't operate. We were out there supplying, so that when others didn't supply, Hema supplied. So we had our revenue was good in the first quarter. Of course, we saw, and there was a lot of panic buying. So people thought there's going to be a shortage. So the first quarter, you have people buying 2-3 months of stock. Then it stabilized. So the pharmaceutical side of it, we didn't have too much of problems. And the pharmaceutical manufacturing was the same. Of course, the second lockdown manufacturing, we took a hit for about a couple of weeks when we didn't know when one employee in the one shift had got impacted with COVID. Till the PHIs gave us a proper protocol, we had our protocols. And till we sorted out those shifts back in, the production volumes were less. So we had smaller ships, so those were the impact. So that's a general, we didn't operate at 100%. Of course, we would have got 85% of our revenues we would have all looked at. However, because it's COVID times, everybody had stopped all these unnecessary expenses. We changed the way we operated. We looked at lean processes. We also looked a lot at digital. So especially on how we took, traditionally you would go physically to take an order. Now it's digitally done through the app. The Kade man itself will send it in, or the pharmacy man. So we tried to move into a digital kind of a format. During lockdown, during COVID, when it did infections, the MOH was one contact point. We knew processes, protocols. So I guess we had a lot of support. They were accessible, was the best thing. and they were very committed to allow the private sector economic engine function. So that was there. Yeah. What would I like to see is a pricing mechanism. I waited 5 years to see that. It's still not there, but yeah, that didn't happen. But other than that, the rest of it.
Business leaders need to think through the implication of COVID-19, and we need to dynamically engage to manage the risk. So my question is, where do you see HEMAS in next 5 years?
I guess HEMAS, in 5 years, where would I like to leave HEMAS? It has a leading conglomerate where we would have, I don't know, in 3 years, I'm having ambitions that it would have doubled its revenue in 3 years, and tripled its bottom line in 3 years. So I can't talk of about 5 years, but in 3 years, I'm having a vision of that.
What are the advices that you have to give to the Sri Lankan fellow businessmen to face the COVID-19 pandemic?
One thing is, it's all citizens. Business of people can't chase away anything. It's you and me and everybody in every home, how we behave. And we have to be safe. Now it's all over in every community. If we are safe, we manage, and we know, if it's not a plague, it's not a disease to condemn. Now it's all over. It can be you, it can be me. The problem is, people are shy to say they have COVID because it's like the next person is going to kind of find fault with them, and they look at them as if they've got the plague. All my thing is, all of us have to do our part to be safe. All of us can't be foolish and take our health for granted, and make sure we operate in safe environments. Our companies are also made of people. It's not made of infrastructure. If the people are not safe, the company won't be functioning. That was the biggest challenge I had. How do I keep our employees safe? As a CEO, you want the employees to be safe. You want the employees to come to work and be safe. We need business to run because we need to be paying their salaries. The last thing I wanted to see was giving anybody salary cuts and sending them home and stuff and create more chaos to the economy. But all this starts with being safe. If our employees, that way, actually, I must say, we, within the 5,000 workforce, we had about 3 people who got COVID. Because everybody has to be, my only preaching is, be responsible for yourself and your neighbor and your family. Because if you can't, I can't be looking after all 5,000 and 6,000. Company doesn't function. We will have to be, we won't be, economically, we won't be churning out output. Then what do? We'll be another liability, like the industries, which are liabilities. And they can't help it. That's an issue. But for us, we can help it. So my thing is, look, it's not from the business leader to do it. It is that the culture of the organization, culture of all of us in our communities, you have to look after yourself. You can't be, as soon as you think there is no case, we are running around going about to public places. I know, you know what? Why don't you just spend time at home with families and just enjoy yourself for a while? It's not for too long, for a while. And not be, I don't think, I. So now it's a point that we all have to safely manage with COVID in our lives. We are not going to move it out in any time soon.
A very good evening to you all. It gives me an immense pleasure to deliver the vote of thanks in this event. First of all, I would like to thank our guest interviewee, Mrs. Kasturi Selvaraja Wilson, who honored this function with her inspirational thoughts. Even with a tight working schedule, you gave us a time and you gave a wonderful insight about our industry. So ma'am, I would like to thank you again in respect of my team and my university. And then I would like to thank our beloved lecture panel of Business Economics Department, especially Senior Lecturer Professor Pivitru Janak Kumar Singha and Assistant Lecturer Mr. Dimuth Jayasundara. And last but not least, I would like to thank my beloved colleagues who make this function a grand success. Stay safe. Happy New Year. Thank you.